I think we may have to village meeting about that, but time is acceptable.
Oh, wait, here's one more. So we have visitors, pleased to see people, and, yeah, I have a few more. Including friends from.
ABC 22, possibly.
She's on health.
They're ready to hear the. Yep.
Hear what?
That's fine. Oh, that's ABC, I thought it was Fox 45.
Oh, I saw that.
It's ABC 22 again, Fox 45.
Oh, okay, cool.
Yeah.
So, decide which one you are.
Well, what you call a duopoly, so we're both.
Let me just say, this is a regular meeting of the committee, and it's about our fourth, I think. We're just kind of getting started with some of what we've been doing. So, as you can see, we have adjusted our agenda a little bit to make sure we at least think about what happened New Year's Eve, and does it affect our committee in what ways, which we're not always that clear about at the moment, but we will follow the protocols of the council, which means after we go through an agenda item, we'll ask if anybody wants to make a comment or speak. Any questions about what we're doing here?
There is a 3 minute.
3 minutes. And we welcome another council member, Ryan.
Oh, I'm so used to being on the art commission, I thought you remember, but.
That's why it has sex.
Well, I think.
So. Okay, so obviously we have some modifications in our regular committee meeting because of the New Year's Eve event. And what that means, first of all, is that Judith, as a council member, and I guess Brian, if he has a chance to pop up, will talk about the ways in which this committee might end up having either a different timeline or different tasks in some way. But just to give a quick overview reminder, and if you don't have the resolution with the charge for this committee, I'll be glad, I have a couple copies I can give you. But basically, we were set up in July, and our charge was to look at the entire system. We're going to look at the mayor's court, at the Greene County Municipal Courts, the Greene County Prosecutor, the Police Department. So we really had a system charge, like look at everything and how it's going. And we had a 2-year timeline, because doing a, you know, trying to do a scan of the entire system is not something you can do with one incident or with, you know, one interview or whatever. So we then created our subcommittees, most of whom are here tonight, and those subcommittees are looking at different parts of the justice system, the Yellow Springs justice system. For example, there are people who are looking at the mayor's court. Why do we have fewer cases referred there than we used to? There are people looking at the police department, people looking at the community police relationships, looking at just all of the sort of pieces of what happens in our entire justice system, juvenile court, I mean the whole shebang. So that's how we got started, and that's kind of how we've been working. You know, when we finish this first part of our agenda, which is based on what happened New Year's Eve, does this committee need to do it differently in any way? We'll just go into our regular subcommittee reports, in which we talk about what different subcommittees have come up with up to this point in time. So, I'm going to ask Judith to take it away.
Okay, well, thanks for all the citizens who have come. Thanks to the committee. Oh, we need to actually. Call roll.
Okay, call the roll. Steve McQueen.
Here.
Hello, Stiglitz.
Present.
Kate. John.
Here.
Kathleen. Jennifer.
Here.
Lazazu Bitnoy and David.
Here. There.
David Turner.
Everywhere.
Yeah, we Louise, I'm here.
I was going to say, I think it is good to do roll, because especially with people here who don't know
okay,
who we all
yeah,
are,
that's
you know, to get people's names and to know who we are in this section today. But we're just to deliver the way, how we do it. But anyway.
Maybe people could say their name when they speak.
Yeah, good idea. Pat put together, thank you very much, our agenda. We made some, she kind of checked with Ellis and I to kind of put the agenda together. Actually, we should probably say, is this revised agenda okay with the committee? Is there any other?
Yes.
Seems good? Okay. So so after the New Year's Eve event, you know, one of the questions, you know, the question is, how does that affect our work? I'm just going to reiterate, we're a subcommittee of Village Council. We were kind of given our work plan through the resolution the council wrote describing what we are to do. And now with, you know, council has, the only meeting council has had since the New Year's Eve event is the big meeting that many of you were at. And we did not discuss the work as a council. You know, we didn't talk about, you know, do we want this subcommittee to do something different. So I wanted to propose that the committee say to council, we propose that we do this in a different way, because the message I heard at that large meeting and the message we've been hearing from citizens, you know, on the streets and emails and so on, is that some changes need to happen quickly, more quickly than what we had, our work plan had, you know, we were really thinking, the kind of recommendations that we make to council. The committee is recommending policy to the council. We're not telling the police department directly what to do, anything like that, but the, you know, we're recommending policy to the council that would, you know, give direction to PB, you know, the Banners Court, etc. So but first I wanted to just, so that's what I would like to propose is part of what we do tonight, is that we agree on, you know, some things that we'd like to ask the council and that we'd like to recommend, rather than just going forward without getting, making sure, you know, as a subcommittee. We're not an independent, we're not like a 365 group, it's an independent citizens group. It gets to decide for itself and it can be a pressure group, but as a subcommittee of council, you know, I think we need to be checking in with the council. I wanted to sort of bring people up to date. Village Council has hired an independent legal counsel. We passed a resolution at the end of our last council meeting, and that independent counsel person, legal counsel person, is David Williamson. He was recommended by the council's lawyer, Chris Connor, to investigate the New Year's Eve event. That is what he's doing. He's from, I'm going to screw this up, Beiser and Greer of Dayton. So it's going to be an internal investigation. And, you know, that had we had a police chief, maybe the police chief would have done it. It's an internal investigation, you know, out of which might come, you know, discipline, for example. So when you have, you know, something that didn't go so well, you know, you have an independent or an internal investigation. That's what this person is doing.
You said David Williamson.
Yes. David Williamson, yes.
All right.
One thing that he is asking for is that eyewitnesses, there's, in the next few days, I'm sure the word will be out, he is looking for eyewitnesses who actually saw what occurred. And as part of that investigation, he's also looking for the videos that people took on their phones. They need the actual video off your phone, not something that's already been posted, you know, but the actual, and it can be put, I guess, now you're talking to someone who doesn't know how to do this, it can be put on a disc, and that's what they need. They need the original stuff, so they don't, you know, they can be clear that it's, you know, it's as it was.
Well, Steve, you did some of this. Do you have any advice about how people would do it? And who should
I think you download it to your computer.
It's not very difficult, right? Like, your charger should be able to split, and therefore you can plug that USB directly into the computer, and from there you should be able to, either your computer will ask you what you'd like to do with the phone, and from there you would just download photos, and photos and videos usually download together. That would be the easiest way. I'm pretty sure you could go to the library and they could also teach you exactly how to do that. But just make sure you bring your charger, especially one that came with the phone. That would be the easiest way to do that, though.
You mean the cable?
I would just bring the whole charger. That way, yeah. Then that way, if they, yeah, they can reconnect it for you or disconnect it for you.
Yeah, and then you just need a DVD disc, right, and to put it onto that.
Or a flash drive, I'm pretty sure they'd probably prefer that. More than that. Yeah.
Okay, all right.
Is the person collecting this going to be available for answering this question?
I think that I'm going to say Judy Kittner, our clerk of council, will have some answers to these questions.
If I have one, which I don't, I would call up and say, hey, who can I talk to?
Yes. Yes.
Judy or somebody.
I would say Judy's the contact person for now because I'm not quite sure who else it would be.
Judith, you may have said this and forgive me, I might have been concentrating on something else, but. What qualifications did David Williamson have to be chosen to investigate this?
I know that I actually was trying to look up. If you go online and look at maybe Ellis knows more. When council made the decision, we just said, we okayed hiring independent legal counsel. We really didn't get any information, so I know no more than that
chose him.
Yeah, the solicitor recommended him.
Okay.
Yeah. And then, yes.
For what it's worth, this is the first I've heard that Dave was being considered or hired. I know him, I've known him for years. We practiced law together 20 years, some years ago. We were both public defenders at the same time. I think of him as very competent. And the kind of person who would want to actually figure out what happened and would be candid about what he found. But I haven't talked to him about this, so I don't know.
Right. Yeah, I met him briefly today. I was just first impression. He seemed very sharp, and so I was kind of impressed with him, liked him. So first impression. Okay, thank you for that.
Can I just interject something about the downloading of the videos?
Yes.
If somebody on this task force could kind of coordinate that, we do have discs in the community access station that people could use, and we could help with that if anybody needed. So I don't know if Steve's willing to kind of be the conduit, but there's a way that we could help with that.
I think that I'm just thinking, Steve's great, awesome, but, but I'm just thinking that maybe they haven't asked us to be in the middle of it, so I'm just thinking maybe it's for the best not to, to let Judy as our clerk. And I think more information will come out as to do that, but that's actually a great idea. We've got the ability to do it here, don't we?
Yeah,
we probably do.
And we have a stack of, discs
that
can be used.
And I'd be glad to help.
You'd be glad to help. So the committee has the police subcommittee, the mayor subcommittee, best practices, the narrative committee that wanted to do research around public trust, and then I'm not saying that very well, and then we have two young people who have been active from the high school who are unfortunately not here tonight. And so one of the things I was thinking tonight we need to do is figure out if we're looking for citizens who could help with the work of those committees. They are work committees. So if people are interested, they know which of those committees they want to participate in. That was one thing I was thinking. We should get your names and contact information. One of the things we're going to be looking at the village is hiring a new chief. And so I know, that you would, that Ellis and others have recommended another subcommittee that would help look at our process, look at the past process, which hasn't been too long ago, job descriptions, qualities, and like I say, reviewing the whole process. And I know Patty's already told me staff would appreciate that help from the committee. So, yeah.
What's the time frame on that, hiring a new chief?
See, council hasn't had a meeting, other than that big meeting. So I don't know. I think that will probably be something to discuss at our next meeting, potentially, just thinking about that question.
So maybe we have a check-in. Do people generally feel comfortable with that idea that this committee would have a new subcommittee and their work would be centered around the process of hiring a new chief, being clear about the position description, maybe the recruitment process, how to structure community interview, I mean, sort of work through that in collaboration with council. Is that, am I saying what you're thinking?
Yeah, and I'm just, it wouldn't necessarily just be people in the community.
No, I understand that. Yeah. But I mean, if people feel comfortable tagging that on.
Is that going to be the big meeting on the 30th? Is that what you're talking about? Your next council meeting?
No.
Is that on the your next
well,
council meeting?
Well, the other thing is, what I'm, this is just talking about, there's this other piece of work, which is not really related to any of the committees.
Adding to our task list.
Yeah, and I don't know if Patty's going to eventually want to have some citizens committee that is separate. I don't know. Again, maybe we need to just clarify at the next council meeting exactly what do you... But
I think it'd be better, and I think it is, to interject ourselves, to be supportive. Offer to be supportive and do what needs to be done. I think the village needs to lead it. It's the council, some of the mayor, and the village manager's job to do it. They should be responsible for doing their job. And I bet they know they better ask for input.
Dave, I'm sympathetic to that position, but we've done it before and it hasn't worked out so great, I guess you'd say. So probably we need to think about how to improve the process so it works better next time. So that would be the, I don't think we would say we're doing it. The idea would be we would come up with ideas about how to improve the process, which we would give to the council, and the council would decide we accept these, we accept these.
Right.
But we have to be willing to do it on a pretty quick time frame, I would think, probably to meet the council's needs to, move ahead with this thing.
Well, the council needs to decide what they're going to do.
Yeah.
We, I think, should say we would be glad to help and add this to our list of things to do. Let us know how we can help, and we could also figure out possible things to suggest that we
actually
already,
excuse me, we actually have already had a little bit of a request via Patty. She did speak to me about could the committee come up or at least review the position description.
Since council has a meeting next Tuesday,
that's soon.
Which is not that far away.
Yeah.
I mean, we could, bring it back. We could, the only thing is that we don't meet again for another 3 weeks. So we have to kind of figure out tonight, maybe what we could say is just, clarify, but we might want to sort of tentatively set the beginning of that committee up so that we can move forward and not wait.
Take some people to be able to respond when council says now we have more details, because at this point my sense is the council doesn't have the details, so there's nothing we can do any but be ready to respond.
Well, part of the question is who's willing to, because we all have got work we're doing right now, and this is a volunteer group, so does someone feel like they have extra space for that work willing to do? Jennifer?
I have a suggestion. This is kind of the biggest emergency we face right now.
Right.
One of the things that we've been tasked to do is, the whole narrative research thing. I think the narrative research is in, And so I would recommend that maybe John can focus, or Steve, who is doing the narrative research? Maybe you can shift, because we've had so much overwhelming feedback from the village on what our problems are that maybe, we sort of get it. We get what needs to be done. And, if you all felt like it was a good use of your time to work on on the chief.
Are you talking about the chief, focusing on
So basically focus on the narrative on the chief.
I would disagree. I feel like the narrative, I mean, Steve hadn't talked about it, but that the narrative interview committee in terms of like getting the sort of granular details of what the police-citizen interactions are, you know, outside of what happened at New Year's Eve and outside of the, you know, the anecdotes that were offered, that I've heard other places, or that were offered at the meeting on January 3rd, I feel like we could still use more information.
I just feel like we need to also, we can't just exclude all of the previous interactions before New Year's Eve, as though this is the biggest thing that's happened to a lot of people. There have been a lot of other very important things that have happened.
That there are other things that happen other than just the New Year's Eve.
If, right, that people would really like to also let it be known to the council that, you know, these gripes have been around for a while.
Right.
And I think the narrative can't just be about the chief and his resignation. That we should get all of it so that we can talk about the police department now versus trying to focus on who should lead a police department that may not have Yellow Springs' best interests at heart. So I say we should focus on the narrative of what people have been saying as well as what just happened. Mm-hmm. What is kind of easier to talk about, but there's a lot of people that have some things that go back a couple of years.
I guess I feel the same way in the sense that if we're looking at a whole system, we're still looking at system, and to take one incident and work from that. Not that we can't ignore that, because that magnifies the policy issues hugely, but we can't totally focus on that in our work.
Do you have a sense of what the council is going to want to do within the next, or after this next meeting? Are you going to assign people to go figure out what to do?
Can you hold that a minute? Let's just try it, because it's lively enough. We want to have people who are holding up their hands, like John. Go ahead. Come back to you, please.
First of all, I do have actually more to say about what the JSTF shifts and goals and timelines, and I also wanted to say, and I know I should have brought this up when someone asked about whether we were okay with the agenda, if we could just ask after, between the JSTF role in the next council meeting or next public meeting and the clarification discussion regarding multiple community groups, if in between there, maybe we could open it up to public comment to once again sort of like see where people want their goals to be. All right, so now bringing it back to the subcommittee on the new chief, can we just see a show of hands for who would be happy to work on such a subcommittee? Okay, so no one?
No, I would.
Okay.
Are you talking about the audience as well?
Oh.
Or just us?
I would stick to the task force and...
Okay, well, let me try and summarize what I think Jude said.
I guess I was thinking that if there wasn't enough people here, like if no one here wanted to work on it, then I was going to say, well, maybe people in HRC.
Let me just summarize it, please. So Judith is saying there is a council meeting next week.
Next Tuesday,
a week from today. So that would be appropriate for us as a task force to approach the council and say, of course, we're interested in being helpful within reason. You know, what works? We've heard there's an interest in working on the hiring of the chief, and we're willing to have some discussion about that. And there are people, we need to think through how we would involve other citizens who have an interest, but there are people on the committee who are willing to do that. Is that accurate?
No.
Okay, well, we need to keep going so we can get our
work. Well, I was going to say, so should we identify who's going to kind of on the committee be a part of that?
Right, so Al, Pat, and Dave had said they were willing to at least think about it.
I feel like all we can do is wait to be given more specifics. Okay. So I'm willing to be on the group of people who waits for that and then respond as appropriate.
Okay. Okay.
We have nothing else we can do.
One thing I was thinking of each of our committees, because we've got all these people, and people might say, well, I would like to help on this committee or that committee, is having a contact person so people can contact, you know, whichever committee they might want to help do some of the work of, so that, because those meetings are, you know, decided, you know, by those, that couple of people in the committee, so.
Okay, but, let's so, move on with shifts in goals and timelines, yeah. And what is your thinking or?
My thought is, you know, I heard at the big meeting, and I've been hearing it, that people want some policies to change quickly. I've also heard from other areas that we should wait for the new chief. So I think it would be good if the committee, and we might want to hear from other people, you know, we're going to have, that we say something to the council at their meeting next week about what we think, you know, about that in terms of, are there some policies we feel we should try to move forward on more quickly?
Al, do you want to say something?
I would like to just, I wrote out on Stemmer's committee a part of it. I think it was relevant to what you're saying. Last Tuesday's council meeting gives me hope. When was the last time 300 villagers were so united? The time that comes to my mind is the Save the Farm, and you were very involved in the Save the Whitehall Farm. We had at least as many people, very enthusiastic. What happened? Al Denman said in 3 weeks' time, over $1 million was raised, and we saved the farm. I think the energy and the concern that is united everyone. We need to act. We need to do something quickly. I mean, otherwise it's just going to spill over into anger and frustration. So I think it's really paramount that we get and do something concrete very quickly, and the council would be.
Other people want to speak to this?
So we did discuss this at our. We had a meeting of the. Best practices subcommittee.
Can you speak up?
Yeah, you can speak up.
Oh, sure. Hi. Good to see so many people here. The difficulty is it puts a burden on us to try to be interesting. I'll try.
And louder.
And louder.
Yeah.
We had a best practices subcommittee meeting last week. Jennifer was there. I was there. Carmen Culotta, who teaches at Wright State, was there. And Sarah Wallace, who teaches out at McGregor, was there. And we had this a giant list of possible policies that we could work on and probably will work on at one time or another, but we decided to prioritize a few, but of course it's subject to change. So I'll just tell you what we thought. And this was coming out of the big meeting. We thought that we should prioritize working on restorative justice as it specifically relates to what happened on New Year's Eve, to trying to see if it's possible to come up with an approach that might use restorative justice principles to address what happened there between the police and the people that were affected. We thought that it was really important to try to quickly address use of force and including taser policies. The village has, or at least used to have, a taser policy. I haven't seen it in a while, but clearly we need a policy that protects people from inappropriate use of tasers. I don't know if they have that or not, but we can look at that quickly. The thought was that we could also look at multi-jurisdictional emergency response protocols. There's some reason, some way they decide who to call in when, and we've had a couple of examples already of where maybe that doesn't always work to everybody's benefit. So we would probably we could look at that in the short term. We talked about citizen police review boards. I know at the meeting at the church. Prior to the big Tuesday night meeting, that was something that there was a lot of interest in, and we could orchestrate a discussion about that to see if something like that is in fact appropriate for us. And then finally, and this is not to exclude other ideas, but this is just what came out of our committee meeting, mental health interactions, and primarily that's on the list because somebody that was at our meeting says that she's primed and ready to work on that in the short term.
So each of the subcommittees has probably some policy has kind of floated up as being either very obvious, right. Well, we've got to do this one, or urgent in some way because of New Year's Eve. So one possibility is we go to the council and say, we can do an interim set of recommendations within a shorter period of time. And that would be like phase one, right? Phase one of our reporting. And we would then continue. What does that sound like?
It sounds good. I think if we, if the committee agrees that that's something that we felt that's what the village is asking for, that we go a little bit longer. I appreciate the particular suggestions of the best practices committee. That we just think, are there some other things that we'd be very specific to council? We say we could look at, you know, taser policy. We could look at restorative justice. You know, whatever. And so I wondered if people are in general agreement, if we want to hear from the committee, you know, so that we can, you know, present that to council next week, and maybe we want to hear from, you know, if there's anybody out here that has
right.
some other.
But I think each committee has something they can bring forward about, well, the mayor's court has come up with, yeah, we really need to at least consider X, Y, Z. The police subcommittee is like, well, we think it'd be useful to look at. So I think it would be something where it would come out of each subcommittee. These are things that are being either very obvious or something that we think needs consideration.
I mean, in terms
for,
of...
I'll give you a really obvious example. We've had a big fail twice now with how we do orientation for our newest officers. We lost the last one because he wasn't lined up, or we didn't understand that he couldn't be quite as aggressive as he was. He didn't get it. Within a very short period of time, he didn't get it, and he was gone. And now we have a new officer who's been through this trauma of New Year's Eve. I went to look at her training records. What are her training records? Taser? Really? Taser? And preparing cases for court. So we have a problem with how we bring a new person into the system. So, I mean, each of the subcommittees can come up with, boy, this is something we need to look at now.
Are you suggesting that we do the next few days? I mean, should we talk about that right now for the committees?
Well, we're closer to 8 o'clock, we're having committee reports. So we
can and then maybe forward. We could bring that, those, then we'll...
We'll do some level of drafting, or we'll do some level of preparing it for. I mean, I'm not saying we necessarily give these recommendations next Tuesday.
Not the recommendations, but right. We say we would like to bring recommendations to about these things.
We would like to do this.
Does that make sense to you? Or a list of general topics.
We're not going to bring specific ones at next meeting, but we'll say a topic that we're offering to, yes, because we have a sense that's the citizens want action. Okay,
so can we take time now to hear from citizens? Is that okay? So we're following the council process of 3-minute comments, and again, this committee was... this committee was appointed in the end of the summer. This is our fourth meeting, and our charge was to look at all the different pieces of the justice system and to kind of do a scan, you know, of the mayor's court, of Greene County prosecutor, of juvenile court, of everything. So, of course, the New Year's Eve event is really pinching us about, maybe we need to be a little faster about it. So,
Pat, would you mind if I said one
John
more thing? Because John, and then I'll be quick.
We were inviting the public to speak. Go ahead.
Okay, so I just wanted to say that to the community that when the police department subcommittee met, we did agree that we could use more people, that we definitely already had found enough work for ourselves, that we could definitely use more people on that committee. And that I imagine when the subcommittees do their reports, everyone could talk about whether they think bringing on more people would be helpful.
Okay, thanks.
And then the other stuff that you guys were talking about, we're going to come back to that. That's going to circle back to
that.
There's one thing I wanted to throw out here that might be the kind of thing we want to look at early on. And I want to say it now because people may want to respond to this when they talk. This is the idea of looking at alternative structures for the police department. We sort of assume that you have to have a chief and you have to be set up with sergeants and do all these things, but I mean, according to Ohio law, you don't have to do any of that stuff. You can structure yourself as you choose to structure yourself. And it occurs to me that maybe some of the reason we keep having the problems we have, hiring a good chief, hiring officers that get the community, is structural. I hear from people all the time that there's nowhere to advance in a small department, so good people leave. We know that people don't just stay in the community, grow up here, want to become a police officer and serve their community. It doesn't happen that way anymore. So maybe things have changed, and maybe there's something we can do structurally that might help us solve these problems going forward. Just doing the same thing, but better, and not do it for us. So I'm not sold on this idea, but I think it's worth considering as you go forward. So if we thought that was worth considering, it would mean looking around the country to see if there are other small departments that are structured differently. Do you take the chief's job and divide it up differently among other people?
I've looked at peer communities in Ohio, but maybe we need to get a bigger. Okay, would anyone like to speak to things we've been talking about? Or anything?
I'm Joan Harris, one of the citizens. I wanted to say to the gentleman in the gray over there that I thought your comment about acting quickly because things are just going to kind of dissipate, people will lose interest after a while, I think that's a very valid point. I'm wondering who's currently in charge of the department, not the chief has resigned, like in the interim while we're looking for somebody else. Is there just nobody in charge?
Well, it's our village manager and then, sergeants, right, day to day. But
so they're kind of running things day to day, and they'll continue to do that until it gets sorted out. Yeah. Someone mentioned the word restorative justice. I don't know what that means. What?
Jennifer?
Well, restorative justice is... it's a system of dispute resolution that's kind of antithetical to the legal system. So where the legal system focuses on what crime was committed and what is the punishment on the book for that crime, restorative justice focuses on harms. What harms were committed and what can be done to restore the community. That's kind of it in a nutshell. So it's a challenge to see how these two things can be combined. For example, how can we go forward with an investigation which might involve, the legal system and concurrently do a restorative justice process? And I just happen to meet the guy who might be able to help us do that if the village is interested in pursuing that. So restorative justice is a way that could be incorporated into the mayor's court, for example. It's a lot less expensive than legal proceedings because it's basically just people sort of talking things out. And victims.
Mediation sort of?
It's like mediation, except that the victim and the offender, or victims and offenders, however you want to look at it, come to some determination on their own. The mediator doesn't offer any suggestions. So basically, the person affected or the victim talks about how what happened affected them and what it would take for the person responsible to re-enter the community. That might mean, it could mean anything for a police officer. But it's a whole different way of thinking.
Oh, sorry.
If you have a little more time, go ahead.
Okay. You had mentioned the newest officer had only two things signed off in her record, and that was the taser and something else.
Right. She was a jail guard, wasn't she, basically?
She was in the security. She was in corrections, yeah. Which would not be an unusual path for a young person. She's quite young.
No, but you make sure they use a taser.
I know, but I just kind of thought, the only... tool you have is hammer and treat things like your
okay.
And when I trained as a nurse, we had to follow somebody else. We had to shadow for months and months before they unleashed us on
That has been her. I don't mean to distort that. She has also been right along with officers for some time.
Okay.
So it's not the total.
If they don't do that, maybe they should.
Yeah. Anyone else like to speak tonight? have a question.
I do have a brief question. Is this the only time for citizen input, or after you talk about committee stuff with citizens?
Well, no, we'll take some time after we do our committee reports. Okay.
Yes?
My name is Phil Farrar, local citizen, parent to adult children. I kind of want to echo the feelings about the urgency involved in capitalizing and taking advantage of people's passions. And maybe more specifically, I heard Judith mention something about people wondering if we should have a new chief before we develop any kind of systemic or philosophical thing. And I, just as one citizen, I'm strongly opposed to waiting on the new person to help establish any kind of change and guidance in our thinking, that, you know, in our utopic fantasy, we have the perfect system that we put any good human being in that spot because the system's already ready to deal with it. Mm-hmm. Fantasy's great, but realistically, maybe pushing for some really clear humanitarian system changes. And I urge this body to ask for the moon. Take really the strongest recommendation. And if, you know, if you're buying a house, you ask to get it for $4. And then this seller says, no, I need more than $4. Well, pick the number that you actually could part with, but start at $4. Get the best, it's not to sound like Trump, but get the best deal you can. take the strongest, most idyllic, realistic, but idyllic recommendations, and if they have to be whittled, pick a point where you don't want to be whittled anymore.
Thank you. Sir?
Bill Randolph, I'm the pastor of First Baptist Church here in town. I heard you say that you were looking for someone to be on the police subcommittee. I don't know if that's appropriate for this moment.
Sure.
I would like to offer myself. I have a background. Great. I worked 25 years in law enforcement out of Seattle University. So I kind of bring a different little bit of a twist to it as well. And also, you know, I don't know.
I know you were involved in the group that came up with recommendations.
Yes. I initiated with that, yes. But also, and again, I don't know if this is appropriate or not, but I'd kind of like to be a part of the Justice Task Force as well.
We have an opening. So we just happen to have an opening. It's on our kitchen. So we'll, there's a little bit of a process we can talk to you about, but yeah, so thank you very much for your offer of service.
I also shared last night with the 365 Project. I don't know if you got
it. I wasn't able to make it. Well,
I know you weren't, but I don't know. I think I sent one out. It was called the Pelion's Nine Principles of Community Policing.
That was
put out some years ago. And also, and I can share it as well, the current president, Barack Obama, just released a 55-page document on the president's role in the justice reform. It was published by Harvard Review. And so I can offer all that work, but, you know. Anyway, thank you.
I'm glad you brought that up. Community policing, I wanted to mention that, because a citizen by the name of Matt Carson started talking about how the police view it, and a lot of people immediately dismissed it. And if you do need to research, there is exactly that. I'm not sure if that's what you were talking about, but there is a concept of, here's the definition of community policing, and then, there we go.
this is Department of Justice, and as you referenced, they've done quite a bit of work with
there are a couple of definitions.
Right, I was going to say they're competing definitions.
Yes, competing definitions. So when other people said, no, that's not it, it turns out to a lot of people it is it. And I think we need to talk about that.
Right.
When we start using terms, restorative justice, it turns out has a couple of other definitions according to who you're talking to.
Right.
So I think we need to really get into the concept of defining
these really
terms for Yellow Springs.
That's a really good point. Other citizens who'd like to speak?
I'm Jim Spangler. I came to Antioch in 69. I've been here pretty much since then, but we lived out in Cedarville Township for 23 years and just moved back into town a year and a half ago. But Jennifer was talking about the story of Yes's. This idea just occurred to me as I was sitting here, so I have no idea about the feasibility.
You might want to speak up.
I don't know anything about the feasibility of going in this matter at all. In restorative justice, where you get the two parties together. Now, I've lived out of town for a long time, even though I was in town, and I don't know any of the police. But as I understand it, there are some good policemen. Mm-hmm. And if there's any way they can get any input in this whole thing, mm-hmm. I think that would be good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, we have to be clear that officers on the department do an enormous amount of community service for the community. Commitment to that.
Tony Berry, owner of Superfly Comics and Games. I'd like to expand on what he brought up just a little bit. 9 years ago, when I opened my business, I knew every police officer on the force by face, if not by name. Today, I know maybe two. I like to think that I am a fairly accessible and prominent community member. I'm not involved in a lot of areas, but I'm out there. I'm in the community, and that I don't know a lot of the police. If I have a problem where I need a police officer, I'm not going to know the person that's showing up. That's an issue that I would like to see resolved in some meaningful way. And I would also like to make a point to echo what Bill brought up. I think if we have a semblance of an idea of what we expect from policy changes, waiting until we have somebody to fill the role and then shaping them to our desires as a community might not be as strong an idea as defining our needs and then finding somebody who will fit that role.
Thank you. Anyone else want to speak at this time? Is there anyone else who wants to speak at this time? Thank you.
Can I just say one thing? Anyone in this room, any person in town, can call the police department and ask to go on a ride along with the police officers. And I did that once, and I happened to ride along with one of the four people who were involved in the New Year's ball drop. And I'm kicking myself. I mean, I said I was very disturbed. I shared with the group here after I did my ride along. I was very concerned with some of the attitudes I saw, and I objected a little bit to him, but I felt I was sort of being privileged to ride along, so I didn't want to be too outright. But I think it's our responsibility as well to help the policemen, to educate them, and I'm wondering if we couldn't have more people riding along with the police officers on a regular basis. I think they might learn what the values of the community are. We could, I suggest we get out and walk and sort of meet the people. We could do things that would help the police officers to be engaged in the town. So I think we have a responsibility too. It's a difficult job. I mean, you see people, these police officers shot in Orlando. I mean, so I think as a community, we have a responsibility also to help them, whomever they are, and to help get them on track.
Thanks. Oh, one thing I
do want to say, in terms of council meetings, we had said we were having a meeting January 30th, but that is not happening. And the reason is because the independent investigation by this outside person, he has other work, it's going to take a little longer. It's going to be sometime in February, and that meeting date will be, because at that meeting, that report, you know, his report will be presented to the community. And so just to say, the date is changing, and we'll probably find out at the meeting, at the council meeting next Tuesday. And that's another place where the committee may want to say we can do something there. Maybe we present what we're doing at that time.
Okay, the next thing on our agenda is to just speak briefly about the fact that there are a lot of, see some of them here in the room, concerned citizens who've already done a lot of good thinking and work, and we've received through the council, through individual emails, through Facebook, plans, recommendations, suggestions for policy change. So, and some of these things were worked on even over the summer. I know that Reverend Randolph's group worked over the summer on recommendations. And of course, HRC did a lot of thinking and working about the ways in which the community and the police could have a better relationship. So there's lots of things out there, and we're trying to, I got started with one little tiny list that's in this packet here, but we'll keep expanding it and keep in contact with people who want to keep working on it. And again, if you, any of you in the room want to participate, please just bring your name forward. And there's some really great work that's already been done. So Gavin Leonard, one of the people you've worked with, is going to be here today because he has quite a 12-point plan already worked out in his head about things to think about, but his kids were sick and couldn't come. But there are people and groups who are working on this and have already done a lot of really great work. Kate, do you want to say anything about HRC's work in that regard?
Well, the last time we had forum was October 2014, I think, and a lot of the issues are the same. We did a survey, we had boxes around town, we had 70 or, how many people? We have 70 or 80,
yeah.
The forum that we had in all the different rooms. And so then we took all the information from that and tried to whittle it down to the 5 points. And some of those we've already done, like getting off the task force. There was also, Chief Hale had said that a goal was to always have an officer who had the crisis intervention training, the 40-hour crisis intervention training, not the 6-hour, the 4-hour, the online, whatever. That has not happened. And I'm trying to see if I can find this so I can tell you exactly what the next part was. And public outreach, transparency, accountability, people were concerned about that. People also were concerned about the mayor's court. There was confusion on the criteria and process.
And this was 2 years ago.
Yeah, these are things though that are still coming up. Right. And then the fifth thing from all of this was that people really wanted a community committee, a panel, a place for villagers to vent about treatment they've had with the police. We do get that at HRC, and we encourage it because it is a way for people to get heard by a council member. Our liaison is Marion McQueen, and it's not as intimidating as, say, a council meeting. So those were the 5 points that came out, and really it seems like the only one that's been accomplished is getting off the task force. The other 4 points.
Which was important. Pretty important.
Yes.
So, okay, just one example of people who've already done a lot of work. So there is work out there, and we don't want to necessarily repeat what people have done, so we want to be aware of that.
I would suggest,
trying to collect it.
Sorry. I would suggest, too, that you would talk to the last, or at least some of the people that were on the last chief search committee because they do have very specific issues with how it was done or not done, and I think that would be really helpful so you don't just repeat the same process again. There were a lot of people that had a vested interest versus more citizens, I think.
So whatever, if we are part of a new, you know, assisting council on the search, it seems like that's the place to start. What you're suggesting is looking at the old process and talking to the people.
And having a lot more community input on it. It's done during, you know, with surveys or having people email or just coming to the meeting somehow to incorporate more voices into the process. If it's possible.
Does Human Relations Commission, this is another commission of the council, is there a piece of this work that you guys are, you know, that you would see, you guys?
Well, we've done a lot of work on policing issues in general, I'd say, in the last 2 years.
Yeah, yeah.
Steve is on CRB.
But
correct.
We didn't necessarily, were you on the search for the chief? I wasn't.
No.
I don't know that anyone on HRC was.
I don't think
was.
HRC, right.
No, we haven't really, we didn't really do anything with that. I mean, we've had the police come to our meetings, we had
right.
the chief
give
lots
suggestions
of topics,
about it.
Yeah. So.
None of us were on the actual.
But the Human Relations Council had that big meeting where we listed the criteria we wanted for the police chief. Mm-hmm. That happened mm-hmm. prior to the...
Right, that was our opportunity to
right.
tell council this is what people want when it comes to a new chief.
That was our first or second. I can't remember. We also had another
it was, well,
with him.
It was my first, but it was the HRC's second.
Yeah. Yeah, we've done a lot of forums and things like that. And we do have lots of interested people on HRC that could help with things that we just have to figure out how to do that with the Sunshine Law. Because everybody on our council is interested in being involved with the policing issue. So, and I'm sure there's lots of people in the community.
So we're now shifting our agenda to subcommittee reports. So.
Oh, no. I wanted to speak to the current agenda item.
You wanted to speak to, sorry, what?
To the
current agenda item, you said?
Yes.
Go ahead.
I guess I feel like, you know, we should look at how to make our subcommittees and JSTF more accessible. Maybe like improve the JSTF webpage that's on Yellow Springs. YSO.com or whatever, which is currently, I think, only has the agenda for this meeting and like nothing else. And put contact information for each working group on there. And
maybe sorry, I didn't want to follow. We should put this information on the web page?
Yeah, so people can contact
more accessible
each. Yeah, so that the working groups are accessible and have maybe like a listserv, like an email address, such as like JSTF at whatever for each thing, or at least like a directory that just is like, this is the contact person, email them to get a hold of us, and then have each encourage folks on each group to put up, you know, their documents as they're producing things that are, you know, public ready to make them publicly available, and, you know, furthermore, ask the community how we can be more easily engaged, because I guess I really feel like, you know, JSTF with its, the Justice System Task Force, with the charge that it's been given by council, which is like very broad, and even though it you know, was sort of set up in a not very, it's almost like it was set up, like if you were going to set up a committee to address the problem to address the New Year's Eve incident, you would essentially give it the same charge that we've already been given, which is like super great. Like I feel like we're already sort of well positioned relative to the levers of power to like bring about the sort of changes that people want, and the way to bring to like help the community sort of realize and determine its goals better would just, in my opinion, be to bring more people into.
So So you're imagining broadening the network and broadening
the communication. Yeah, into the subcommittees, which I know I sort of already said, but I just wanted to put it out really clearly for the community.
Okay, as far as, go ahead.
I have, to some extent, I agree with you, John. I think, you know, I count seven groups, there might be more, you know, that are focusing on caring about discussing the same kind of thing, this being one of them.
Exactly.
And I'm a member of four of those.
What are they?
Well, let's see, in various ways, dealing with, but yeah, the HRC 365 group, the Young People of Color subset of 365, the no-name group that, you know, John and Bill put together, you know, the council, but it's a group. There's another one I thought of.
And what your point is, there are a lot of groups out there.
My point is a lot of groups. Everybody's having the same. Everybody who's not energized and concerned, raise your hand. Okay, so we don't need to have that discussion anymore. You know, we all care. We all want to do something. I'm an engineer. I want to do something. So I think, you know, having a whole bunch of groups talk about it is fine. We have been tasked by council to do something.
Right.
The community is coming and expecting us to do. Let me finish. And I think that communicating more with people what we're doing, getting input is good, but if we try and have too many people participating in the process, it's like Monday night, and then we're not getting anything done.
Okay,
we have a commitment, I mean, I'm almost done. We have a charge by council to do
right.
some things.
We know that.
We know what we need to do. We're trying to find out some things to change. We should just do that ourselves.
Okay, I think you've said that, David. So what John is saying is that we're not that well known, is one of the things he's saying.
Mm-hmm.
And do you have any reason to think we shouldn't tell people that we exist?
My point is more we should not work too hard to try and grow our group into the entire community of 3,500 residents of Yellow Springs.
Okay.
Oh, yes.
Do our jobs and communicate it to people.
Okay, we got you. And you feel...
I do kind of agree with that. Like, for example, like, I'm not sure if at this point growing, like, the interview committee would make sense, for example. But that that growing the police department subcommittee, on the other hand, like, I think we could double that group even more. Like, make, I don't know. Like, maybe
okay,
even
well,
nine members, and, like, there would still
right.
be, there's just so much work
to
be done.
Let's go on to our subcommittee reports, and each committee can speak to whether they feel it would be really useful to have more people join them. That's one thing you're going to report on. Report on what you've done since our last meeting, any highlights or insights you want to share with the public, whether you think the group needs to be larger, and whether you feel, you don't have to talk about them unless you want to, but whether you feel that there are clearly some immediate recommendations that you would feel ready to make to council in the next month or so. How about that?
Good.
Okay? So let's hear first from the best practices. We heard something, but let's hear more.
I'll start. Basically, I gave our report a minute ago.
Yeah, you get
the part where I said, you know, we prioritize stuff. If people would like a copy of the best practices minutes, here they are. I don't know if you brought it, and everybody's got it in their packet already. Here's the people. Everybody's already got it in the packet. We have a long list of possible areas to work. We prioritize some areas to work. We have two people, Jennifer and I, from the committee, and then added two other people from the outside. I think we could definitely use some more folks. People who either know something about court practices or police practices, or really like doing a lot of research. I mean, that's sort of the criteria for being of help on this particular committee, I'd say. We're going to meet again sometime soon. What is that?
25th.
Thank you. On the 25th. And Jennifer, you want to add something?
No, that's pretty much it. I've just been doing a little research since we met, and I don't have anything to really, you know, pronounce at this point, but I did make a really good contact with someone who seems to be the authority on combining restorative practices with police work. So I'm excited about continuing the conversation with him. And he gave me even more resources, so you know I feel like I'm down the right rabbit hole with that.
As far as what we talked about prioritizing, and so
right.
I think probably people would agree that a TASER policy is important. People would probably agree that restorative justice, at least as it relates to the incident, would be important. I'm wondering how much priority, and I'm just talking about time priority, people would put on citizen police review boards, an idea on that.
Now, Dayton does have a, what do they call it? I think I brought it with me.
They have a police appeals board.
Well, it's more of a citizen engagement.
I was actually involved in designing that many, many years ago.
The Community Police Council.
Oh, maybe that's...
Is that the one through the HRC in Dayton? Because they also have something similar.
Well, it's not unknown that people have these councils, and I don't know how effective they are or what, how they connect. Yeah. One of the more interesting ones I heard about from someone was one where after the whole thing's over, they bring together the officer and the person who was arrested and try to build a relationship, better relationship. Interesting idea. Mediation services maybe could have done something like that.
There are literally hundreds of these things around the country, and there are four or five different models, and there are pluses and minuses to each model. Some might be appropriate, some might not be appropriate. Maybe the whole idea isn't applicable here, I don't know. But if people thought it was a priority, we could orchestrate a conversation about that. It may not be a problem.
Conversation, I think.
Well, I mean, the reason not to prioritize it is that...
Is it a fair amount of work that would
take? I don't know. I mean, the reason... Everything's a fair amount of work, it seems to me. The reason not to prioritize it would be that there are all these hiring things, training issues that... obviously need to be done up front. This is you're kind of figuring out the best way to close the door after the horse has gotten out of the barn. If something bad has happened, how do we figure it out? We might want to prioritize things that keep bad things from happening.
Well, you got to do both. If you don't pay attention to your mistakes and learn from it, you're an idiot.
Yeah. I don't know. Would people want to push the Citizen Police Review Board kind of policy to the front?
I like the idea. I mean, if I had any ink in my printer and had printed out what we went over with HRC back in 2014, I actually link to this, and this is the Human Relations Council of Dayton, and they're the ones that do this community police relations initiatives. And I mean, they're willing to talk to us. They're willing to let us see how they do things. I believe her name is Catherine Crosby, and I admire them, so I was hoping that our HRC could be like the little sister for their HRC. But I was learning a lot from her, and this was one of the things. We also had there was the Dayton Mediation Group, is that what they call them? And they came in and talked to HRC last year, and that was really interesting too. We have a mediation group that we don't use very well.
What's this list of things that you're considering adding to or subtracting this subject from?
You don't
what you
read
listed
it, do you,
before?
David? You've got
no,
it.
No, this is what you're reading before, right?
That was the list of, those are the things we prioritized from a list of about 20 possible.
And my understanding is that you're saying, should we add this other one?
No, this was on the ones I mentioned. But I'm not convinced that it's something that we should do in the next 3 months.
Yeah, because that seems like a downstream decision.
It came in at the bottom of ours in 2014. That was the fifth part. I don't think that it's the most, I don't know the right word for it. I don't think that it's, I think it's still last on the list. But I think it's still important.
But if you remember at the meeting at the church, this was the one thing that or maybe it was just the way the meeting was chaired, it was the one thing everybody raised their hand and said they were interested in. Mm-hmm. So there you have that.
That's the exciting stuff, though. Maybe that's why all this research is
on. I just wanted to say before people might leave that maybe have some interest in participating, that again, Judy Kittner could be the connecting person. And I want to give out her phone number so that you could say, I want to, just a simple way to connect to our committee if you don't know who we are, know how to reach us. And that number is 767-9126. So if you have some interest, you want to reach one of us, want to participate in a little some of the work, call Judy, she can hand it to Pat.
Could they email too?
And you can email
the easiest way is yso.com.
That's clerk@yso.
.com.
Some people don't use the phone.
Okay, well, thanks. Let's go on to the police department. And John, among other things, and this is in the packet, wants to have us review. I hope it's in the packet.
Oh, no,
it's in.
All right, so just to come back to what Athena asked, so are we going to open up for public comment after each committee report?
No, I don't think we need to do that. If people raise your hand and really want to join into the particular topic,
okay.
Pay attention. First, pay attention.
All right. Okay. Cool. Yeah. So we've requested, the citation data from the department. Computer's been broken, so I've been able to do much with regards to that. But additionally, I don't exactly have all the skills to do that, so I wrote a sort of draft job posting for hiring an intern to help with quantitative analysis. I was thinking of maybe shopping it around the statistics departments of nearby colleges and universities, and maybe using some of the money in the money that council set aside for committees to pay that person some kind of stipend.
If you're going to suggest that, if you're going to actually shop it around, and you'd have to write a letter to council saying we feel like this would be really helpful to our work, and this is about what we think it would cost, and
right.
You know, council would have to okay it.
Right, and before that, I thought I'd run it past.
Yes, absolutely. So you're asking what people think.
Yeah.
So let me repeat what he's asking for, that we would ask the council for some amount of money, very modest amount of money, to pay a stipend to an intern sort of person who could help us with this very sizable amount of data, try to analyze it, organize it, and so on.
Does that make sense to you?
Well, I don't think it could. Why don't you speak briefly about what you're going to find, or what you hope to find, and illustrate in this analysis of the
data? Okay. So the data includes basically every misdemeanor, minor misdemeanor, and felony charge that the department has issued from 2000, partway through 2010 to basically now, and finding basically patterns of, you know, times of day versus like when those charges are written. The charges, another field is like the officers that are writing them, and another field is the addresses. So like where are these things happening? The race of the person charged, looking at sort of racial profiling. Although the data doesn't currently have it, I think that we could get the ages in there. And basically looking at, obviously a lot of the citations that are written are the sort of thing that mainly just result from officer-initiated contacts. If you're pulling someone over for a broken taillight, obviously no one called that in, and certain drug charges are probably, you know, the result of officer-initiated investigations. So it's sort of like, would sort of reveal what the department and officers are seeing as priorities for investigations, which I think is important information for us to understand.
And it answers the perception, anecdotal, that is out there among certain groups of people, for example, very young people, teenagers,
mm-hmm.
that they're being targeted in some way. So is that true or not? Well, maybe this data could help us understand that.
Right.
That sounds good to me.
Sounds like a wise thing to do.
We have a lot of people that seem to want to help. I'm just wondering if we're not taking advantage of the fact that someone might Well, we volunteer that.
Right.
That time to do so, or at least their evening hours for the next few weeks. Yeah, right, see, we already announced that you're asking for it.
I'm not that nerd, but if I were, I'd do it.
I mean, we may find a graduate school, if, a graduate student, if we query.
That could give credits or something along those lines versus just going directly to it. Right, and good resume stuff, there's a lot of ways of looking at this rather than just a video.
Jennifer, do you feel like if John, if it sounds like the committee thinks it makes some sense, if John writes kind of the, whatever you wrote, this, is that something, Jennifer, you as a person who worked with students?
I could certainly take it around Antioch.
Okay.
But I think, you know, we've got Wright State and Sinclair and, I mean.
And how much money, do you have any clue when we're talking about a stipend, the two of you?
Well, we're talking about a time limit, correct? Like, we now want to get this done faster, more than detailed. So if we're talking about a time limit, then it's a per hour situation, which would help them go faster. Or if you have a deadline, if you have 3 weeks, we pay this amount. But it has to be done, like how do we, how
do we work it? I think we probably want a cap.
Oh, I think it's been a.
My degree is in research and statistics, and so when you're trying to decide how you're going to pay this person, I just want to caution you to remember that you're going to be doing this in layers. First, you're going to want to do like some basic description statistics. You're going to want to get that out fast. But you're going to want to do some long-term studies, answer some of these questions longer. So you might want to do this in pieces rather than sort of try to think about how you're going to have to pay them for the whole thing.
Would you be willing to give us your name and phone number?
My name is Athena Fannin, and I'm happy to consult with how to do it. I just prefer to keep my hands off the data because I don't want anybody to perceive that I've come up with a corrupted outcome.
Okay, so Athena, you're willing to talk to John about this?
The broader,
the bigger, how to go forward.
Is that okay?
Yeah, for sure.
You would also suggest that Antioch has something as well, right? I remember writing it, that they have an actual, I forget what, research.
They do have a.
Okay, how about if we let John talk to people and figure this out?
Yes. I just wanted to make sure that it was like, that people were okay, comfortable enough. That, like, you've given me enough that I will obviously look further.
He also has this document on Google Docs. I apologize to anybody else. So I thought I sent it to Judy, but it didn't happen. So.
Are we giving our blessing? Is that why you're bringing it up, right? Like,
okay, so you're giving me enough blessing that next time I'll come with something more specific.
Okay.
I agree there.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, Kate, do you want to say anything you haven't shared with us what HRC has done? Since I had looked at training pretty extensively, that is, what does the Attorney General require? What do we require? I was interested looking at the incident about what's there, and clearly, as someone's already said, the TASER policy, which is under the use of force, that's where you find it, under use of force, that it's not just a policy, it's the fact that in order to save money, we have used Officer Rowley as our trainer, and he is the officer who came off of the drug task force and sort of tends to have a more aggressive approach to citizens. So there's a question of internal training and whether or not that's the best way to go about this kind of training, whether or not our officers actually need TASER, but that's something else. And then crowd control and de-escalation, I mean, that isn't really that much of an issue, but it does, that's how it was perceived by duty officers. And they actually have taken courses in crisis intervention, de-escalation of mental health crisis, use of force liability. They've had quite a bit of training already on things that you would think might inform them to consider some other options. So that sort of raises the question about what is this training? In some cases, it would be an online, two-hour online course. So then the question is that really enough for them to really come up with other tactics? So I'm still interested in continuing to see what OPATA, which is Ohio's Police Academy, they're the ones who provide. In fact, our officers would not be able to receive any state reimbursement if they take a course For example, many entities have suggested inherent bias treatment. Inherent bias being
implicit bias.
Sorry?
Implicit.
Yeah, implicit bias, thank you. Something of concern, but it's not yet offered in WPATA. Actually, the way it's offered is, it's kind of complicated, but they're looking at a criminal having that problem, not them having that problem. So, and this training, of course, this bias is epidemic. I mean, kindergarten teachers, firefighters, it's not just police officers. So, but it, right now, only the Federal Department of Justice Department has created something for law enforcement in this kind of training. So we still have some issues about training that people in the community think they should have that really doesn't exist. Or if it exists, it's incredibly expensive. So that's an issue that I've been interested in. And then I'm also interested in, I got from Chief Hale, he was interested in this and looked around. He was interested because of staffing. But he identified 10 peer communities in Ohio. And I'm, so he wanted to know how are they staffed and how many people are on the force and so on. So
what is that? I don't actually know.
Peer community would be, what is the community that's about our size and which the median income is the same, which is a similar police officer and some of the same factors, like maybe they have a big corn festival or something. Something that's similar enough that we can make some comparisons. So I'm very interested in that too, and I've continued to do some research about that. What are peer communities in Ohio that we really can look at, and how do they do it? For example, Oakwood has peace officers who are both they're both firefighters and peace officers, and they switch from time to time.
So if they're a peace officer, do they carry a gun?
Yeah, they're
officers,
I think.
They're,
I'm not totally sure about that.
I mean, I wonder what's the difference between peace officer and police officer.
Well,
they
grant you peace officer. Yeah. You didn't make that up. They actually
call themselves peace officers. They call themselves peace officers, yeah. But they're police, and they're police officers.
So
but they circulate
guns.
Into the, sorry?
So it's bringing nerve guns instead of police.
I don't think so. But, so that's an interesting, we're talking about other structures. There are other communities out there that are trying different things, so that's something I'm continuing to.
But we do have one police officer who was part of Miami Township Fire and Rescue. David Meister is on the
board. Oh, is he on
the board? He's a fire EMT and police officer.
Yeah.
And I would be, if I didn't take this opportunity, because I take it every time I can, I still would like us to consider having a social worker work with the police department.
Yes.
And I have found some communities that do that, and I'm still looking into that more.
That's good. And we have determined by looking at police logs over many months that our officers are engaged in police work, considerable amount of police work. We're talking about someone who's threatening suicide, teenager who's run away, some heavy duty things. The challenge is they'll go into it and do whatever they can do, but their training is limited, and they don't go back. They can't go back. I mean, they can, but they don't have time to do that. So if there's a rough situation in a family, or I was just thinking about maybe someone noticed about 3 weeks ago that officers were called to someone's home to help them find their reading glasses. And I thought, well, I wonder if that was an old person who's very isolated, doesn't have any help, doesn't have relatives nearby, but they're not going to do that because they just find the reading glasses and disappear.
Right, so the social worker would be someone that could connect the dots and say, did you know that this service is available? And the officers do that. I've seen the police officers. They have a stack of, business cards about mediation and different things like that. But a social worker would know all of the resources that we have. And you would probably know a lot of that type of stuff, too, if you're working as a hospital
staff. So you could get a case manager on it.
Even a part-time social worker could do that. And they make around the same amount as a police officer when you factor in all the extras, health insurance, et cetera. It's about even.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Great.
It's good to keep bringing up, and I think.
Yeah, I'm going to keep digging around and finding people to do it, because there is actually a social, there's actually a degree in police social work, but I'm not sure that's exactly the same thing.
Do you know of other communities that have this kind of person on there?
I'm still looking for some, but I have found a couple. But it's a, it might not be the same type of social worker that we would need. I don't know. I just think it would be something, you know, if 80% of the calls are social work and 20 are emergency, and then they're trained 80% for emergency and 20 for social work, there's something not working there. So.
One would imagine a social worker on the force would be cross-fertilizing in terms of what the police department would increase their ability, the police officers, as they're working, you know, side by side with a social worker. Mm-hmm. The information, I mean, they would become better informed, yeah, as to how to interact, and then also they know they can reference, refer that person to the social worker when they're on, if they're not on. So it sounds like a, yeah, something, a good idea.
Just one other thing about training to share with citizens, I think I've shared with everybody here. Last 2016, our full-time officers only required to complete 11 hours through the Attorney General's Office of training, assigned, some of it assigned.
That's the state Attorney General.
Yes, Ohio's Attorney General's Office. This year, it's double. It's up to 21 hours maybe. However, only half of those are paid for. So if our officers take 21 hours required by the Attorney General's Office, and then we come up with a list of five more things we think they should do, they might never get in their car. But, so, and then who's going to pay for it? So that's a challenge. This is a challenge.
Maybe somebody could look at their budget and just see where the most emphasis is put on. I know that when I talked to the chief about the 40-hour crisis intervention training, he said, well, we send an officer there, then we have to cover this. But where's the money going in their budget? And maybe it's going someplace that the community doesn't want to be behind, you know.
Right.
For a while we were on SWAT. There's like $3,000 of SWAT gear somewhere. Maybe the community wants more of their money to be on training versus new cars. I don't know.
Right. So. But they are required to take certain courses.
Right.
That we are required to pay for, in addition to the ones we might wish they would take.
When you said half are paid for, you say they're paid for by the state, but is that what you mean? Yeah. So the other we are paid.
The other we pay for.
Yeah, that'd be interesting to see how many hours they take altogether, if you could see what they have to take and see how many hours.
How many hours?
Then you
that's
could
a very
out
good point, because some
how
of
much
those courses are 2 hours.
Right, then you could see how much it would cost, because then you'd have to cover their shift. And,
so in the end, they're, you know, just saying more training in X, Y, and Z is going to cost time and money and confusion and scheduling. It's not as easy as saying go send people more training.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, we hear that people aren't happy. They need this training. Well, they get a lot of training. It might not be the training we want them to have, yeah, but they do get a lot of training.
I was just going to say, it sounds like a lot of the training is in front of a computer course where they're working. They're isolated. They're just taking a course.
That's
by
an
themselves
option which they choose, because they don't have to go drive to Columbus or something.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, just to say.
And that's another thing too, because there's been a lot of discussion. Everybody talks about the differences in 9/11 and what training is.
Right.
So just getting trained.
Right. We've all been trained, right? Everybody's really been trained at least once. So, you know, we know it's not always. Some people are
untrained. I had a question that touches on Kate's idea of a social worker on the police staff. I was talking with our chief of security at Antioch, and he said that there are police departments that instead of having a chief of police, there's kind of a civilian in that office that could be, you know, a social worker for someone else who's more of an ombudsperson or a, you know, facilitator type or mediator type.
So, you know, that's another thing to look at, getting out of that model of having a chief of police at the top could be something radically different.
He's saying that instead of a chief, you have your
you have a different professional.
Uh-huh. As that would play that leadership role.
It would play a leadership role, but right. Have sort of a different.
Maybe
focus.
Have a different.
And does he know of a community that does that? Or several?
Yeah, I think so.
That'd be good. Just look in.
That sort of gets at
your mind.
Yeah.
Okay, moving along to the mayor's court.
Okay. You can tell me I'm wrong as appropriate.
I am not on that committee, by the way.
I mean, well, I'm going to talk about some of the things that you heard Ron Lewis talk about. So this is you know, my interpretation of that. Now, our research and considering the urgency and importance of other issues, you know, we feel that we can wrap this one up. And I'm just going to read, you know, what I put together that we talked about. And Mayor Fobert has spoken and given us some data and also taken data and analyzed it. And Steve's talking to him, and I've heard him talk about this. And that's where a lot of this comes from. The average number of cases seen in mayor's court in the first couple of decades, the past 25 years, is about 20 or 30 a month. As of August of 2016, there were 16 cases for the whole year. And the chart that we showed the previous meeting was showing, you know, data over the years, some years more, some years other, but dropping off. In the past, the cost of mayor's court has been borne by fees and fines, which total, I might be off on this a little bit, about $30,000 a year, but recently, and losing money because the last two chiefs have had the officers send more cases to Xenia. That's sort of our conclusion, but the number of cases going to Xenia goes up, the number of cases on mayor's court go down. That's how arithmetic works. There are a few types of cases the mayor's court may benefit from changes in handling. Their frequency seems very low. Some are outlined in the memo from Ron Lewis to Chief Pettiford. The process can be modified to accommodate these concerns. Not sure what exactly that would entail. Sometimes there's a mention of, oh, if you had a prosecutor, life would be better. We believe that we should have the police directed to send all possible cases to the mayor's court, period. Mayor Fobert had indicated also a feeling of some disrespect of the court by some of the officers, we feel the police department and the court should have an opportunity to resolve these issues in mediation or some suitable process to help out with that. In the end, mayor's court can pay for itself without being a money-making device instead of losing money. And Mayor Fobert said that he was told in the beginning of his tenure that you're not supposed to make money. So don't worry about that kind of a thing. Just do your job. It's a place that can provide local control using mediation, restorative justice, and community involvement in problem resolution versus really punitive actions by non-residents. This can help guide young people and first offenders much better than the Xenia court can. Public sentiment favors mayor's court, even though John and Steve are going to continue interviews, at least that was the plan. This afternoon we were talking about it to find out people really hate the mayor's court, which we don't think is the case. And it's possible for people to say, I don't want to be in mayor's court, I want to go to Xenia. So maybe offering the opportunity to not get local justice and go to Xenia would be a thing to do, to deal with those three people every 20 years. So.
I have a question.
Yeah, I was going to say, in terms of if you're bringing a list of things, if we're going to bring to council next week, the idea that we would like to bring you some recommendations. One of the things, and I know, you know, this might need some a little more detail, but, you know, we may want to ask the council to set the policy that misdemeanors, maybe with some exceptions, or if there is an exception that a police officer, I mean, this is my thought, if there's some reason they don't think it should go to mayor's court, that they have to actually say why, because basically the policy is set. I mean, that would be something we might want to recommend.
Sure.
We may need to look at the details, but anyway.
Well, related to
that's
that, I was
exactly
just remembering the memo. The memo from the prosecutor saying, send these things to me.
Right.
So we would have to negotiate that with the prosecutor?
And that's not my understanding.
No.
The memo was saying some things you can't send, murder, you know. But there's some things that we can. So all the things we may hear. We don't need to do any more research, I don't think. That's pretty simple.
The statutes that set up mayor's court limit its jurisdiction and take certain cases away from mayor's court. So, for instance, DWIs where there's been a prior can't go to mayor's court. And a couple of other instances, certain crimes of violence can't go to mayor's
minors.
Court. We're only talking minors, they're, yeah, if you're all juvenile cases go to juvenile court unless you have some other agreement. So what you would say probably is every case that mayor's court has jurisdiction over should go to mayor's court, if that's except if you've got a good reason not to. Because the statutes do take some cases just out of the running.
Yeah, but it seems pointless to talk about those cases because the law says you can't do that. So we should focus on what we have control over, not other things.
We did, for what it's worth, we did ask Ron Lewis, the prosecutor, for a breakdown of the cases that get sent to Xenia. And it's pretty clear, obviously, that it, for a while there, it was everything but traffic, and now it's everything for the most part, which isn't that helpful. But we would like to kind of, if they're able to break down the cases for us, so then you would know how many petty thefts, how many, you know, domestic violences, whatever, are being sent to Xenia, that'll give you some idea of what's being charged here and elsewhere. He hasn't gotten back to me. Did he get back to you, Dave?
Pardon?
Did Ron Lewis get back to you?
No.
Okay.
I thought he was going to get back to you.
And a footnote is that the training for case preparation is carried out by Ron Lewis.
What does that mean?
Getting ready to go to court.
And you were just saying the officer. Mm-hmm. Just to say the state misdemeanors, say we directed, and we should know specifically what can go to mayor's court, and say council would make the policy, everything they can show that this is what they are. I had understood misdemeanors went to mayor's court, but you know, Mary Ann McQueen was not in mayor's court, her misdemeanor charge. So that shows, that's just an example for out there, that misdemeanors are not going to mayor's court.
So you don't have as much power as you thought you did, is that the...
Well, no, we never set the policy. Council never set the policy. I thought I understood that from our administration, that in fact, but you know, obviously it's not the practice, which we know if there's only 16 that went in the whole year, it can't be, right?
Well, who decides right now whether the officers...
I think the chief allowed, just said the officers get to decide, and there's been a lot of, I think, communication over the last few years that it should go to Xenia. So
well, there was a letter from Ron Lewis and Xenia, brought the prosecutor in Xenia to Chief Pettiford, saying you should send most of them.
Other departments do not work that way. So here you see there's no question. It's interesting that we do have a chief that allowed that. That's not common practice. Just want to make sure that it is. That
generally, there's more
times.
Direction that
correct.
The officers
if
are getting.
This happens,
we want you to do this.
That.
Yeah.
Correct. And so it's very odd there.
Well, my understanding, correct me if I'm wrong, in the way the chain of command works, you guys tell the village manager how to do the job, right?
Well,
Steve and John,
So on the mayor's court committee, so do you guys feel like you could draft that recommendation without what cases?
Like specifics? Absolutely. I think we can do that before the meeting.
Well, you don't need to do it before the meeting because we're going to ask council. I think we need to get their buy-in that yes, we want these recommendations.
Yeah, that's the meeting I'm talking about. I think we've gathered enough information that we can specifically say these cases.
Yeah, and if
we recommend
can help
these cases.
Well, no, let's clarify this. We're not actually making the recommendation.
No, we're not making the recommendation.
We're asking the next meeting.
That was our recommendation.
Yeah, right. Okay.
We're recommending that we recommend.
Because we're a subcommittee of the council, and you know, I want council to have a discussion about do they want this committee to, you know, focus at a quicker action plan and respond. response to the New York New Year's Eve event. And that we say to them, and these are the kind of things we're thinking about. We could make recommendations quickly. And council says, yeah. Then the next meeting we have, we can go over the recommendations that we want to provide to them for the meeting after that. So I don't think we bring it to this next meeting. We need to first make sure council has the buy-in, and you know, citizens' pressure that yes, we want something to happen quickly is what is part of you know what ensures council.
This would be phase one. This wouldn't be the end of our committee.
No,
we'd still have work to do.
No, it's just a quick response.
Okay. Don't know if there's any more we can research.
Great. So you guys can write the recommendations and bring it to our February meeting.
Let me suggest this. You know, what we can do is talk with Ellis to make sure we know what the, all of those pieces are that can and can't.
Yeah.
Put that in it and add it to you know, what I read, which is what I wrote for our subcommittee, and then that would be the subcommittee's final document.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's fine. Yep.
Steve and John, narrative research, and you have a protocol interview with letter, and that is on Google Docs. Is everyone now on Google Docs or know how to get on Google Docs?
I'll talk. You have my email, which is not a Gmail, so I can't get on.
It's not hard to get a Gmail.
I do have Gmail.
If you have Gmail, then we'll definitely get you some.
And I think I resent it to everyone as just attachment files, right?
That's what I
got you.
Yeah.
So do you guys have a report? Is that what you asked?
That's basically, yeah. How, what do you guys think about the interview template?
It did run again, yeah. It's more of a, this is how we want to go about getting our interviews started.
You want to describe it for the public?
Yeah.
We have a letter in the protocol.
Can people read it? Is there something?
It's not in the packet.
Oh, we don't have it in the packet. Well, can you give a...
My
apologies, but I'm going to have to leave that with 9, okay? I've got to be in court early in the morning.
So the draft letter calling for potential interviewees to contact us explains what the Village Justice System Task Force is, and then says that you know we are a working group for the Justice System Task Force. We are planning to interview people who have had interactions with the police department and or mayor's court. Please note that this is only one aspect of JSTF's review of current police department policies and practices. If you have stories of your own interactions with the YSPD and or mayor's court that would help us better understand the department and or the mayor's court, and you are willing to be interviewed, please contact us at, and then we need to figure out what email address to put there. And then please include a phone number where you can be reached. And then at the end, I just basically add a link to the resolution that established the Justice System Task Force. Is that all the information you want to go over the interview template as well?
Well, I think that the template is good, and you want to mention, here, let me bring it up myself, that you're offering to people the ways in which they can be anonymous.
Yes.
Well,
okay.
You want to talk about that briefly?
So this is actually a question that I felt ambivalent enough about that I wanted the Justice System Task Force's feedback on. So regarding the use of the information gathered in the interview, so for people who don't want to be anonymous, I was wondering whether you want the information just to be shared with the Justice System Task Force to inform its understanding of current practices, or whether after the entire round of interviews is complete, we will prepare an analysis of the interviews looking for themes and commonalities among the stories we have heard, and then basically share like an aggregate as opposed to like we can share literally anything from the interviews. Does that make sense?
Yeah, instead of sharing this person's story, just say
I will read it. Option one, the information you provide will be shared with this task force to inform the task force. Option two, after the interviews, we will do an analysis looking for themes and commonalities combined, right? And then option three, for those who want confidentiality, the information you provide will not be shared and is only background knowledge for us. Does that cover it?
Yeah, so the option, so with option one or two, like, basically, I want people to tell me, like, do you want us to go with option one or option two? And, like, we're not going to have both of those. Like, we're either just going to, like, we're not going to give people, like, either we're going to come in and be like, for people who don't want to be anonymous, like, we can use your specific story and tell people your specific story, like, to the committee. Or alternatively, do you want us to tell people, okay, you don't want to be anonymous, so we can use themes, and so if we find themes and commonalities between your story and others, then we sort of share the aggregate. So option one is basically more, frees our hands, like, that ties our hands less than option two. Are you guys good with option one?
Aren't we subject to the Public Records Act? So in other words, if we collect if we create a document, then it is going to be a public record. So
right.
I don't know that the distinction is
the distinction
has meaning in the
right,
real
well,
world.
We'll just go with option one.
Well, is the data that's collected part of that, or is the final document that using that data part of that?
Anything that is a document and anything that you put in writing on a piece of paper as part of your public work is a document. Or you record or whatever.
Yeah, but you, as a member of the task force, didn't put on paper the information I gave you. I put it on paper. I wrote all this stuff.
Like
this is what happened.
Right.
You didn't put it on paper. I did. Is this thing I'm handing you a public document?
Yes, if it's collected, if I have possession of it.
Oh, okay. So I guess you can't do that.
But wouldn't that mean that all of the information he gets from the police department would also automatically be subject for public, even though it's
not it already?
But can't we gather?
Yeah. Hold on, folks. Yeah. Please hold on. Go ahead with your question.
I'm not 100% positive about this. I don't want to trust my memory, but I want to say that there are some exceptions for certain types of information and research, but that needs to be established ahead of time.
Yeah, that's true. This will not qualify for those exemptions.
Yeah.
But if it's collected anonymously, then that's a document that doesn't have somebody's name on it. That's
right.
Yeah.
I mean, you're not obliged to put somebody's name on it.
Well,
but once
you
do,
you can say, if you don't want to see your name and information, don't give it.
Added something else we're doing. Yeah, fine. Right.
But it sounds like the aggregate themes, blah, 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 seems more useful than individual.
But we could do both.
You can do both, yeah.
I mean, like, I guess
there might be
I have a preference for option one, because, like,
well, why don't you just say, if you don't want your information to be shared, don't give it to us, and that covers everything.
All right.
We'll still have to do both.
Anonymous.
We'll still literally have to do both.
Oh, okay.
However, a personal story does make it personal.
Yeah.
Some people may want that, some may not. We'll still have to gather it all together.
So do you have a timeline or a goal in terms of numbers, or how have you got through it?
So we need to get started soon, but then we just need your blessing. We'll get started right away. As for a time period, I know we'll have a lot done before our next meeting next month, but I'm not sure if we'll have, at least have a lot of interviews done.
Okay.
With numbers-wise, we're going to have to get into how many we're going to have to get done within the week and that kind of thing.
Right.
We'll definitely have some work done by February. The goal, let's say, is we should definitely have enough interviews
What is your method for getting the letter out to people saying we're interested in these stories and contact us?
As many ways as we can, because we can't just at Yellow Springs. We want to make sure that we get surrounding towns' viewpoints as well as to how, what their perspective on the police department is or any interesting experiences they may have had.
So what are you going to do? Are you going to put it on Facebook, I take it?
Letter to the editor.
Right, we're going to have to hit a couple of different ones. There are some other group pages on Facebook that might be able to reach other towns. Mm-hmm. There are people that have moved to that are on those that maybe we can spend there's a couple of different ideas we've been sharing back and forth. The other one is just kind of posting up some things and leaving our emails on it. And also just asking some folks if they're around. By next meeting, we'll be able to tell you what's working and what's not, and what we'll focus on.
Okay. What do you want?
Yeah, so great. So you guys say we can start doing interviews?
Yeah.
All right, great. And then
get started.
And then if people are like, "Well, I'm afraid of police retaliation if I talk to you," then we'll just be like, "Oh, I'm sorry, we can't help you," right? Because that's all we can do.
Right.
But that would not count.
We collected anonymously.
Oh, okay. Right. But if we talk to them in person, we just not put their name on it.
Right.
As or not write it down at all. Just use it as background. Okay, cool.
Just document their name on.
All right, cool.
Just specifically ask for consent to put their name on the interview form.
There it is, right. We'll just
And you don't give consent? Okay. And you write the word anonymous where it says name. Okay.
Sounds
great.
I know that this isn't a research project and has different rules, but I strongly recommend that you let people know exactly what might show up. Because you might leave your name off of it, but you might give a detail that identifies you so that people can choose what information they feel safe giving you. So they have a good understanding of what will be provided to the public.
Okay.
We'll define anonymously better.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Okay, we're moving to the place where we want to approve our minutes. Everybody has a chance to easily get them. Approve the minutes from our last meeting.
Okay, cool.
Then one last thing is, we mentioned everybody is either going to get help that they need. I have, with Google Docs, I've had some challenge actually putting up a file. I can read everybody's, I can get in there, but I might need some help with
that. Okay.
So get the help you need to get in and out of Google Docs.
Likewise.
And everyone has
closed.
The number, right?
It is closed, right, to us right now.
Yes.
So we haven't made, this is not yet a public, partly because these aren't finished documents. So, and then related to open meetings, I think I sent email to some people, don't ever reply all and stir this, or don't do that. That's gets us in trouble with open meetings. If somebody sent you an email, if I send you an email, or anybody sends you an email, you can answer them, mm-hmm. but don't answer everybody. Okay, anything else for the good of the order? Anybody who else deserves?
Well, yes. I was just wondering if we, at some point, maybe the proper places at the next village council meeting is to extend it, kind of an official invitation to HRC and 365 and any other groups to combine efforts rather than having a lot of parallel tracks going on. I just want to make sure that we're all kind of working toward the same goals and we're not being redundant in our efforts.
Yeah, I think that's good. I mean, we could talk about kind of a network. That one thing right now is we have a lot of individuals. Not group, I mean the groups, there's three or four, maybe five groups, but there's also another 10 individuals who are sending emails and things, so maybe some messaging to all of them about show up if you're interested. I mean, some of the groups have already done a lot of work and not necessarily ready to jump in and start doing their work. They just want us to know that they did this.
Okay.
So.
But even that would be combining our efforts.
Well, I was wondering, because we're getting so many suggestions, and I mean, the 365 and the No Name Group, they made many recommendations previous, now since the New Year's Eve event, and then another 365 group, and there's a whole list, and then the big meeting at council, there's a whole list of stuff people suggested there. I'm wondering, who's collating all that and getting it to the right committee? Should a couple people that be part of their work? And I had asked, and I didn't get a clear question to answer because council's getting letters, and I would like it, and so I guess I should ask this of council if Judy Kittner could just forward those to us, because, I mean, a lot of those are ideas. I don't know, Brian, what do you think about that? But, you know, we're going to lose these ideas that people have. You got your hand up.
Yeah, well, the no-name group.
Yeah, right. Does it have a name?
Yeah, it's a no-name.
It's a no-name.
It was formed.
All members, don't raise your hand.
We formed it initially as a response to what we had seen going on in Dallas,
right.
Philander Castile, et cetera.
Right.
It was initially just, you know, to dialogue, discuss, and that sort of thing. We got a lot of things together. We had about 3 or 4 meetings. Steve was there, several of the others were there as well. And we looked at the same thing. We found out that we're walking in somebody else's tracks as well. And we're duplicating efforts and we don't really need to. So as a part of that, I think we'll send over to the council.
Yeah, we have.
You guys got it? Okay. Okay, John, yeah, okay. So that way, you know, we can kind of just, you know, step back.
Sure.
And then when we heard about the Justice Task Force, we really could step back now.
Right.
Okay. So the No Name Group has not had any meetings since September.
Right.
Okay.
The one thing I would say is that, like, the 365 group is what I call, you know, NGOs, non-governmental organizations, or, you know, the citizen groups, can play a different role related to, you know, the village council, et cetera, in a way that we can also, but it's a slightly different relationship. So, you know, them keeping their eyes on what the village is doing. You know, there will be times, you know, where the public pressure that, you know, a group like that can bring to bear on making certain, you know, trying to help certain things to happen. Just
well,
to say.
There was a meeting last night at the 365 group, and that was the suggestion. And I would say that was pretty much, you know, agreed to by everybody together.
Okay.
So.
But I do have a question. Oh, and I want to just mention, for people who want to look, you know, I thought the Campaign Zero, which that came from the No Name Group, did it? Yeah. If you go online for the Campaign Zero, I mean, it's got some really great information on it. And so just, you might want to mark that down. That came from the No Name Group, which it's a national thing. And they have, you know, what the federal government should be doing. This is about police reform, basically, state, local. You know, it's got very specific suggestions. It's called Campaign Zero. I don't know why.
That is what you would Google, is Campaign
Zero. Campaign Zero. I Googled it. It's great. It's really good. Very thorough. And a lot of work's been already done, you know, there, which, you know, you can learn from. But I wanted to come back just a second to, okay, the meeting at Council the 17th. How do we want to bring that list of this is where we can help you. I've written down kind of what I've heard people say, and you probably have it in your notes, but do we want to send a letter? Do we want a couple of people to come? I mean, as many as one people to come to say, we want to offer this. How do we want to handle that?
Can you summarize what we're offering?
Oh, well, the question is, you know, what role do you want us to play relative to, you know, the choosing of a new chief? That's
okay,
one
right,
question.
Right.
And then the other question is, we heard from the citizens, the big meeting a week ago, that people want action, they want it now. We heard it again tonight at our meeting, and we feel it makes sense to offer recommendations on policy on this list of things. We could do it fairly quickly, we feel. You know, policy about the use of the mayor's court, you know, is one. The taser policy, another one. Because, like I say, there is the idea, without mentioning any names or anything, that this should wait until we get the new chief. And I personally felt that that did not make sense at all. But I think we need to get council to say, yes, we want you to do this. I think that would, or we need, if they say no, well then, you know, citizens will respond and whatever. I mean, we're going to have a discussion and make a decision.
How does council like to have it? Is it easier for you to have it written out and sent in?
A letter would be good, and then a couple people coming in would be good also, or as many as one or two, whoever, you know, you could see at the
that
meeting.
That was the other question.
Yeah.
If 50 people show up, does that
I mean, I can represent as the liaison, but I think it might be useful.
So we should send back a memo or a
list. Yes, yes.
I don't feel
with
the
list.
I don't feel the list is complete.
Well, it doesn't have to be complete. I think we just want to
we can always go back to them.
The only receipt is the mayor's court recommendation.
No.
We're not sending the recommendations.
We're not bringing this recommendations. We're saying we could quickly, in the next 2 months.
So can I draft a memo and send it to everyone, and then you change it or whatever actually?
Well, council could add to it too, at the meeting.
We could add to it, we could subtract from it.
Okay, I'm just telling, this is a list of what?
Of
priorities, I think.
Of recommendations that we, the committee, feel we could in the next 2 months, yeah.
Sorry, do you want us to bring recommendations?
There's a word that I want.
Yeah, so it's sort of fuzzy, and it's okay that it's fuzzy, all right.
Well, I mean, we said several things tonight already, that, you know.
But there's a lot of redundancy, everybody's gonna say no takers, so, you know, that's easy.
Right, so that might be an example, but I just.
So Dave, maybe a way to think about it, sorry to interrupt, is not recommendations, but areas that this group could research or bring recommendations on.
I think we're gonna say that our research has shown us some priorities that are obvious and clear. We'd like to present these as phase one. We would like to present these recommendations at the next whatever.
I don't.
Well, we have to go back to our committee, so we're ready, and we take it back to the council. But I think it's worth being real specific about, you know, because council might say yes to this, no to that. Okay. So you're gonna put that together?
Yeah, I will do a memo that tries to capture that, and then people, and I'll send it to our committee, who can.
Send it back to Pat, but we should have a discussion on that if we talk about it.
Okay. Is there someone here who would like to add to your process? Heard enough?
I think one of the things I wanted to hear, I just went over into the bathroom, which was how do I get my nose in this business? I heard an email address as I was walking back in.
Oh, Judy.
Was that conversation happening? How do I volunteer to help?
I see. Well, I mean, you can give it to Beth, you can give your stuff to Beth, or Beth, Pat.
Or it's clerk, right?
Clerk@yso.com is another.
That was happening just as I came back from the body.
Just title it that it's for the Justice System Task Force.
Yeah, because if you want to be a member of this commission, then that should go through the clerk. It should tell you how to do that.
And she could forward it to the right person too.
Judy, if you say it's Justice System Task Force, and I'll let Judy know, she might be here.
Judy is willing to do.
Yeah, yso.com, yeah, Yellow Springs, Ohio.
Judy is willing to prepare, you know, small packets for us anyway, but so if you, before the next meeting, if you want something, you can send it to me, certainly within a few days, so that she has a reasonable amount of time to do it. And I can send it all, I can collect it and send it to her. Which I thought that I did, but somehow.
I can't believe I wrote that. Send to what clerk?
Clerk at
YSO. Clerk at YSO, right?
Well, not YSO.
Not
YSO.
Yeah, YSO. Yeah. I'm sorry, I say YSO too much. YSO.
So on that accessibility issue, I'd like to ask the committee for their blessing in terms of talking to the clerk about how we can set up the web page to make ourselves more accessible.
Great.
Can I have that blessing? All right, thank you.
And then once that's done, like, where do you think they're going to be submitted to? Is that also going to go to the clerk first and then to you, or how are we going to be able to?
That's what you'll talk to her about.
Yeah, okay, gotcha. So like ideally we have listservs for each subcommittee, but if that's too hard, then we'll just have a directory of contact people.
I don't think
you'll know process.
So that it's not going to the clerk, but going directly to the committees.
We don't.